Hi everyone, and thank you so much for this opportunity to share case studies with you on participatory research. So first and foremost, I'd like to introduce myself. As I've said, I'm Rehema Abaya, and I am primarily an artist, and I also create digital content for organizations. And in this capacity, I also work with organizations as a research assistant. I've been working at Heart Kenya for about 8 years now. And within my time there, I've managed to interact with different stakeholders, and one of them being survivors and victims of human trafficking. So what I'm going to be sharing today will be specifically on participatory research, where we managed to engage with survivors of human trafficking to be able to collect data for our particular objectives in two different researches. Okay, so let me start with the first one. Okay, so our first research was a research that we are working on, and it is still ongoing. We are working on it with the Leeds Beckett University, and this is a research in counter-trafficking protection policies that are currently existing in Kenya. And these are the objectives that we had specifically in this particular research. We wanted first to collect and analyze narrative data from victims of human trafficking in Kenya. When we say narrative data, we specifically mean we wanted the survivors to have an opportunity to share their experiences from beginning to end in the form of a narrative, whereby the data is collected without too much interruption, and after they have explained their story, or after they've shared the experience, we're able to use prompts to be able to fill in gaps in their narrative that we think are important for the data that we are trying to collect. Secondly, we wanted to, now having this information from the survivors, to develop innovative and creative ways of presenting and communicating the results of the narrative data collection, and give it to now policymakers, because we need the policymakers to understand what is exactly happening on the ground. And in reality, as people who are working in the organization, we can't really fully know the scope of what is happening except for the survivors and the victims. So it was very important for us to collect all this information and share it now with policymakers. And that is the stage that we are currently at, where we are now trying to disperse this information and share it to policymakers. And then now our third objective, which is what now we are still looking forward to in the future, we want to try and influence the policymakers so that they can improve the implementation of the Kenya counter-trafficking protection policies. Okay. Now, let's go through this process. I've put it in a step-by-step process so that you can understand how we managed to conduct this research up to the point where we are at right now. So the first thing that we did, and this is one of the interesting qualities or characteristics of this particular research, is that this research was going to be conducted by survivors of trafficking. It is survivors of trafficking who are going to take up the role of the research assistant, and they are the ones who are going to be collecting this data from other survivors of human trafficking. So our first stage, because we've already established that we know we want survivors to be taking charge of this data collection, we had to establish survivor leaders. By survivor leaders, what do we mean? At Heart, we've been working with different survivors over a duration of time, and we've managed to see different potential that each individual would probably have. Some are more, how do you call it? They're more versed in particular skills, or they're able to do particular things a bit better. So for this specific selection process, we did not have a method of how we're going to select them, but rather we just went through our files and we checked on which survivors would be open to take up the role of the research assistant. Now, all survivors go through different things during their daily lives, okay? And you cannot really know the stage at which someone is, because you're not living with them every single day. So the first thing we usually do when we want to engage any survivor on any project is we take them through a mental state examination. So they have to go, they have to, for right now, because we don't have abilities to meet physically, so we just create, we create sessions for them online with the psychologist, where the psychologist, having known what we're going to do in this particular research, they can assess, and they can also just do a quick check-in with the survivor to know where they are at currently and if they will be able to participate in this type of role, specifically as a research assistant. Because you see, for this particular case, you see, a survivor of trafficking has gone through their own traumas, and they've been working through them, and they're trying to stabilize themselves. They're going through economic empowerment, and they're trying to try and live a dignified life. But at the same time, it is not that they've lost their memory on what happened to them. They still remember clearly what happened to them, and they're trying to live with it. So exposing them at the same time to a situation where they are asking another survivor to share a story which is of more or less a similar nature can pose some risks, such as re-traumatization. So we have to make sure that the survivors are actually, even the survivor leaders, that they are actually prepared and ready to take on the role of this particular process. Now, after that, we took the next step was to explain to the survivor leaders what the research was about. Now, every survivor at heart has to sign an informed consent form. When we say informed consent, we mean we lay out everything in detail of exactly what this research is about, you know, exactly who, what we want to do with this information, who we are going to share it to, how we are going to collect it. We lay it out in the consent form. Okay. And then this consent form is usually administered by the caseworkers. Why do we choose caseworkers? It is because the caseworkers are continuously working with the survivors. They're continuously engaging with them. They're continuously interacting with them. And this is a familiar face. So if this is someone who can explain to you clearly, this is the process and this is what we are trying to do, there's a higher chance of the survivor understanding what the process is about, without getting too fidgety and getting too sometimes when you approach a survivor too rapidly without notifying them, or when you're a stranger and you come to them and you're like, oh, I'm from Heart Kenya, and this is, they probably will not want to communicate further with you, and you can easily make them panic, and they will wonder, what do you want to do with this story? Why are you taking my story? So we try and use the relationship that they have with the caseworkers to administer these particular consent forms. So from this stage, we went now to doing the orientation, because these are not professional researchers. We want to give them we give them a short session or soft skills for them to be able to understand what does it mean to be a research assistant, and what would it mean for you when you take up this role, when you are going to be administering, when you're going to be collecting this data. And the orientation training mainly involved them first understanding, yes, they've signed the consent form, but explaining it to them as someone who's going to explain it to someone else. Okay, so they had to learn the steps of how to explain what a consent form is, or how to explain what the consent is about to the other survivor. Once they had explained exactly what the consent form is about, we also took them through some discussion prompts, because we explained to them what the narrative data collection process is. We explained to them that first and foremost, you have to introduce yourself, discuss what the consent form is about, let the survivor on the other end give you a response to the consent form. And by this time, usually have sent the consent form to the survivor who is now being interviewed way beforehand, so that they're able to look through it and they're able to read everything and ask any form of question. So this is more like a procedure as part of the interview process. So once they agree on the consent form, which is usually very, very quick because they already had it before, we now proceed to the process of collecting the data, which was now the narrative approach, which now the survivor would just explain. They would start from maybe who they were as a child, and they would explain their story from beginning to end. And now the survivor leader would now check the prompts. They could keep checking the questions that they had, and checking to see what has been answered, and they tick it. They know this one has been answered. And when it hasn't been answered, to just pause and wait until the narrative process is complete for them to be able to ask these questions, to be able to fill in any visible gaps in the story. Now, throughout, the survivor leader has to be very aware that our main focus is to test policies. So within the orientation, they're also trained on the current existing policies that are in Kenya as regards to victim protection, or rather as regards to human trafficking. So within the first section, because the first section of the interview was just an introduction, who am I, where I was born, and things like that. But then the second part was specifically focused on finding out, do survivors know about the protection policies that are available in the country? What would they change about these protection policies that are available in the country? So this particular part of the policies was the heart of the research. But obviously, when you're starting the narrative process, you want someone to tell you the entire story, because it would be very easy to see if these policies were utilized, or if they knew about the policies, or if what is written in the policies in terms of victims' assistance was actualized within the process that this victim was maybe moving from one point to another during the human trafficking process. Once we had our survivor leaders ready, because that was the first step, we had the survivor leaders prepared and they knew that they were going to be conducting this research, we now had to find interviewees, which is now the survivors. So for this research, it had taken part in two stages. In the first stage, it had taken part whereby we had survivors from Heart Kenya interviews, survivor leaders from Heart Kenya interview survivors from Heart Kenya. But this time for the second phase, because we are also trying to diversify our sample space, we decided to look for a partner organization for them to be able to provide us with a different type of group, like survivors who we haven't assisted, because we noticed in the first set, the survivors that we had assisted had very similar responses when it came to victims' assistance, okay? So we wanted to test with survivors from a different organization, have different responses. So we approached Trace Kenya, and we asked Trace Kenya to help us to come up with a list of survivors that they felt could be interviewed specifically for this research. And they gave us a number of 10. They provided us with a list of 10 contacts, their names and their phone numbers. And these names and phone numbers were given now to the caseworkers, because we cannot just automatically just start talking to the survivors. The caseworkers have a protocol on how they're going to be engaging with survivors. And one of the things that was clear in our protocol is that first we have to screen, we have to introduce these survivors, as much as they are from another organization, we have to introduce them into our VCMS system, because we have our system where we now manage our cases, okay? So we have to create a case plan, and we have to introduce them into our system where we do screening, and we also check if they have basic needs that they're missing. We check all these things that we would normally provide to any survivor of trafficking, so they are introduced into our system. Now, when we started, as I've said, we had 10 survivors. But by the time we were doing the interviews, we had 5. So why is this the case? This is because in the first meeting, when the caseworker started calling these survivors, because then I think Trace just gave us the numbers, and they hadn't briefed the survivors on exactly what they were going to do. They just told them another organization is going to call you. So when the caseworkers are calling these numbers, first and foremost, 2 did not pick the numbers. So we ended up, after a week or two, we only had 8 survivors to work with. Then during the VCMS system, during the screening and introduction into the VCMS system, 2 survivors were introduced to the process, but they say they do not want to be introduced into the VCMS system, which is okay, because at the end of it all, it is the survivors to give consent on the things that they want to do and the things that they don't want to do. So from 8, we were left with 6. Now, when we had 6, we were almost very close to starting conducting the interviews, and we were prepared. But as we were trying to call them now to just start scheduling the orientation meeting, because once we have put them in the VCMS system, the caseworkers have explained everything, they have gone through the screening, we have introduced, because we have to introduce the consent form. This is also done by the caseworkers, because as we've said, the caseworkers have a protocol on how they interact with survivors. So they have checked the consent form, and everything has been laid out that this is a particular research. So we know 6 have confirmed that we are going to be working with them. But at the point where we are trying to contact them to join the orientation meeting, one of them contacted the survivor, contacted the caseworker that they were speaking to, and they told them, I feel I am in a position that is making me unstable, and I don't think it is advisable for me to participate in this. So I would really like to pull out. So the next stage was to do our orientation. Now, we did this myself with also the psychologist present, because sometimes during the orientation, as you're explaining the process, things can change. So we always try and have our psychologist present in all these. Maybe she has an emergency or she's engaging with another survivor, but we have a protocol that we've shared in the team at HART, where we are able to manage a situation where a survivor might need emotional first aid. And the interviewees were also 5 in number. So somehow at the end, it managed to fit in a way that we could have one survivor leader interviewing one survivor. And the data was collected virtually because the team that we're working with, first and foremost, this is Trace Kenya. The survivors are all in the coast. And the survivor leaders that we have at HART are mainly in Nairobi. But obviously with the COVID-19 precautions, I think even if they were both in Nairobi, we would still try and utilize online means as much as possible. Now, within these interviews, the one-to-one interviews, it would be one survivor leader who is interviewing one survivor. But within the same meeting, the research assistant would be present. And this meeting, I was the one present. And the idea there is to just keep them comfortable so that they know they're not in this on their own. And just to observe anything that any key things that you can see from their preparedness, from sharing of information, from any emotional changes, all those things are there. The research assistant has to be there to be able to observe all these things. Some to be mitigated, especially for example, like an emotional state change has to be. You have to step in and to make sure that the survivor either takes a break or if they feel like they don't want to share their story anymore, it is okay. Yeah. So within the data collection process, as I've explained already, the narrative interview process, that is the process that we used. And one of the things in terms of key observations, as I've just said, we're just checking because the survivor is leader is still a survivor. So we need to check in terms of how prepared are they to conduct this interview. You can tell within the first 5 minutes if they are nervous or if they are comfortable. And then also for the survivor, because they're going to share a very intimate story, something that actually happened to them. Some survivors were open to sharing their story in full detail, even more detail than they had put in the case, in the case system that they had given to Trace. Okay. But then there were some who were not so comfortable in the beginning, but as the conversation kept going and they began creating a familiarity between each other's survivors, more was able to be shared. Okay. In terms of change in emotional state, we had one survivor who, because the story that she was sharing really affected her. She couldn't talk somewhere in the middle and we had to give her a break, which is one of the protocols that we have when you're conducting the interviews. At any point, whether the survivor leader or the survivor needs a break, we give them a break. And she would take breaks in between because the story was very affecting her. I managed to conduct emotional first aid within that interview, but immediately after the interview, we scheduled an emergency session with the psychologist. So now, when we are talking of filling gaps, it is because, as we've mentioned, the survivor leaders are not professionals. Okay, they are not researchers. So sometimes, in the process of asking a question, they can forget something that you train them on, or they can get a little bit confused or maybe a little bit shook during the interview process. So they would ask questions mid-interview. We had that already established, that when you're doing the interview, you can always just text quickly, say you have a question, just ask, you need help with translation or anything, you just ask. And I was there to provide this specific support. And the interviews would run smoothly because you do not want, as the person who is asking the questions, as the researcher, you do not want the person you're interviewing to tell that you're nervous or to tell you do not know what you're asking about. So we had to create that system where in case of anything, they could just quickly ask on text and we could just respond so that the conversation can run smoothly. Now, in terms of giving feedback, these same survivor leaders would ask because they're very interested in building their interview skills and building their research skills. So they would ask, how did I perform? Did I manage to ask questions properly? Did I manage to just give them any form of feedback? So during the interview, it was very important for us to note everything that they're doing well on things that they can also improve on. And then we would give this feedback at the end of the interview. Now, as I've mentioned, this is still an ongoing process. The data has already been collected. It has already been analyzed by our lead researcher. And this data has been used to draft questions that will be posed now to the different stakeholders, inclusive of the government officials. And hopefully with this, because now we're going to the third objective, where we will now start to test the existing policies and to push these stakeholders, especially the ones in government, to try and utilize these policies that are existing. Because as we know, sometimes in Kenya, it's not a matter of a lack of policy, but it's a lack of implementation. So we try and push for the implementation of the policies that are already existing, and also to introduce or adjust the ones that are existing to make sure that they're more effective. Okay. So that is the first case study. Now, within this same case study, this is one of the responses that we got from now the survivors. Okay, so we're asking them about policies. This is one of them. This one says, initially, I was not aware of any policies guaranteeing my protection as a survivor. It is after returning to the country that Trace Kenya started training us on several protection policies. The organization explained to us the procedures that we need to consider in case one is traveling, what to do when you're being mistreated, who to contact, and how to go about it. So we collected different responses, and this is all part now of the analysis, whereby now we want to know what survivors know about policies, what gaps do they have, where they do not know, how can we make sure that they know, and things like that. Some key findings, I put up a couple of them from now the research so far. Some of the respondents understood the policies, which was really encouraging, and it was really good. As much as they did not know, explaining the policies to them made them understand what they were. But in truth, they were not really aware on the specific protection policies that are available. Because you see, for a survivor of trafficking, especially when you're coming into the country, for example, and you've just come in and you need to get assistance, it would be good if you knew where to go and what to expect. You understand? Especially that when you're moving in between the borders, when you're coming into a country, it is the government that is almost like your parent, you know. So it would be good to know the protection policies that are currently existing. So even when you're approaching the different, say you need assistance from a particular government institution, you have an awareness of what you need, okay? Some were aware and some became more informed during the training that we have sometimes. Because you see, at heart, when we are working with survivors, we don't necessarily just rehabilitate or assist them, give them basically, but we also teach them about what human trafficking is, and we try to explain to them their rights. We try to explain to them in case of this type of trouble, this is where you should go and this is what you should do. These are the laws that are here to protect you. So we try and explain all these things as much as possible. Now, another key finding was that the existing policies are understood by the survivors, and these policies, they're meant to address the needs of the survivors, okay? For example, if I come from the Middle East and I come into the country, most of the time when the survivors arrive here, they have nothing. They literally come back with nothing. So when they arrive here, because the government has to be receiving these people, knowing that they're survivors of human trafficking, knowing that they're victims of human trafficking, when they arrive here, they're supposed to be provided with some support, you know, because if you're not given adequate support, for example, if it's even basic food, you're given shelter, you're given clothes, sometimes some of them come back with literally nothing. They can't even get transport to move from the airport to their homes, okay? So these are things that we noticed in terms of survivors' needs and them not being fully addressed by the policies that are existing. Some of the recommendations that we got from the survivors themselves were, the government should do more in repatriation process of the victims, because as it is, the victims are the ones that pay for their repatriation instead of the government, which usually forces the victims to go back to their captors in order to make enough money to return home. And this is something that I've heard repeatedly from different survivors, especially when they share their story, when they have the strength to actually share their story. They usually have that particular problem where their employer was not paying them anything, you know. And when they get to the point where they're moved from their employer and they're taken to maybe a safe house or a shelter, the people who are managing the safe house and the shelter, they'll provide you with some food on particular days, but they will not necessarily help you to get back home. Okay, so you have to either start calling relatives, or you either have to start finding menial jobs to do around a place which is foreign, because this is a foreign country with foreign laws, and you have to find a way to make money in order to return home. So that would be something that would be a good thing for the government to be able to do, especially when it comes to the repatriation of the victims. Another thing would be the government should establish follow-up programs to monitor and facilitate the progress of the survivors of human trafficking, which is what we spoke about before when we said when the survivors arrive, we want to provide them with, yes, the basic needs, we want to provide them with a sustainable way to be able to progress, to move from the victim status, to be able to be survivors, and then furthermore, to be able to empower them economically so that they don't fall back into being victims of human trafficking, because it's a vulnerability, it's a susceptibility to trafficking, it's poverty. You know, all these things are making them more vulnerable to trafficking. So we try and mitigate those risks by creating programs that can monitor and facilitate the progress of these survivors so that they don't get re-trafficked. And then the last thing I want to present on in terms of recommendations would be on grassroots awareness campaigns. And we do grassroots awareness campaigns as organizations, but the survivors thought that it would be nice if the government also took part in this. Because you see, the government is a big body. It is the entire country. You know, it has the widest reach. If the governments, the local communities, the chiefs, the police, they all took this upon themselves to share awareness on human trafficking, to expose this crime of human trafficking, many more people would be aware of this, and it would be easier to spot someone who's been trafficked. It would be easier even for the community to be involved when it comes to stopping human trafficking. Now, this is a second data collection process, and this was done between Heart Kenya and United Ways Worldwide. Generally, it was United Ways trying to find out how is human trafficking in Africa, specifically for focusing on Kenya for this particular in this particular moment, because they have done the same process in Ghana and they were going to do the same process now in Kenya, because they're trying to understand human trafficking in Africa, and they had picked specific points where they were going to now come in and work with an organization that is already in the country working specifically in counter trafficking to try and find out more about how the human trafficking situation is. So just as with the first process, we're trying to try and collect this data. Generally, we had a questionnaire, and this questionnaire had some guiding questions which were now created between Heart Kenya and United Ways, whereby these questions, if they were posed and they were given to survivors and to the youth, because for this project we were also interviewing the youth, we were also interviewing stakeholders from different organizations, we were also interviewing government officials, because you cannot know the scope of human trafficking in Kenya if you do not involve all the stakeholders, okay? So for this one, for this specific part that I'm sharing on is specifically for the survivors, but the survivors were somehow also merged in some sections with the youth. Okay, so now the first thing was the identification. And for this one, we had the psychologist also come in and step in to be able to help us identify. Currently at HART, we are working on a way to be able to, we're coming up with a policy to be able to work with survivors on a continuous basis. And one of the things that is going to be included in this policy is how we identify who to work with, what process are we going to use. So for now, since we do not have that, we rely a lot on our psychologist to be able to guide us. Okay, can you try this person, so that you can see what kind of outcome you can have. And same thing, we also, they went to the caseworkers, whereby the project was proposed to them. And the consent forms were also given to them, and they read through them, and they also decided if they wanted to participate or not. We had a list of around 8 people in the beginning who wanted to participate in this particular process, but we ended up with 6 at the end, because this is something that is expected even from us. Not everyone is at the same emotional state or the same mental state as you when you are actually approaching them to participate in a particular process, especially that they are survivors of trafficking. We expect that some of them will not be ready to participate in this, and we make it clear to them that in case you say no, it is still okay. You will not lose anything from what you are getting at HART. You will not lose the services that you are getting at HART, or the assistance or the help, anything. Everything will stay the same. This is a very voluntary process. After this, we took the 6 that we were working with through an orientation process. And the orientation was just to explain to them exactly what we want to achieve in terms of doing a landscape analysis, for them to feel free to express themselves in terms of their understanding of what human trafficking is within their communities. In this one, I was with the psychologist throughout the orientation. It didn't take too long because it was a very easy process in terms of explaining what the analysis is all about. And the survivors were very open, and they would ask different questions just for some clarity. And within 30 minutes, we were done with the orientation. Now, with questionnaires for this, because this particular research had questionnaires, for questionnaires, because you could just give them the questionnaire and they could feed it in. But you see, survivors have, how do I put it? Especially with long questionnaires, you can find yourself having difficulty getting the responses that you need. Someone will give you one sentence, someone will give you one word. So we thought we would move these questionnaire sessions specifically now for the survivors, because for the youth it was easy, we just shared it with them. But this one for the survivors, we thought we would have a one-on-one interview process whereby we ask these questions on video. We ask them, we ask for consent to record the videos and that we would discard the videos after we were done. But we ask the questions on video and they would answer in full detail, and then we would transcribe these answers and now provide these as now the filled-in questionnaires. After this, we had a focus group discussion with now the six survivors, because you see now with the question and answer session, the focus of those questions was more of a personal experience where you spoke about your experience of trafficking, you spoke about your step-by-step process, you spoke about things from a personal point of view. But now for the focus group discussion, because now they were going to start bouncing ideas off of each other, which was very good and it was very interactive, it was now fully a discussion on what is on the ground in terms of human trafficking in Kenya. And we managed to have the discussion for about 40 minutes. And later we gave the survivors the opportunity to select one or two leaders from the six, they selected them themselves, who are going now to participate in a conference, because for this process, all this data was going to be presented in a conference at the end of the data collection process, which is which now the two survivor leaders would now represent the entire team in that particular conference, and they would have an opportunity to present what they thought about human trafficking in Kenya. So now during this preparation for this specific conference, after having the focus group discussions, after having the interviews done, two survivor leaders were selected, one female and one male, and they sat down and they reflected on the process and they reflected on the responses that they gave and the responses that their counterparts gave, and they came up with what they wanted to present as individuals. And then now we had a short meeting with them so that we have an alignment on which part who's going to present at what time and which part on who's going to present at which other time. So we had like an agreement. We had like a short 30-minute session just to make them understand, especially because you see the conferences, you have to prepare survivors so that they know how many people are going to be in that conference, where is that conference going to be held. So we explained all these things to just prepare them mentally. We also talked about the logistics on how we were going to have them move from their homes and come all the way to the conference and back. All these things were cleared up in the preparation stage. When it came to the presentation, it was very important for our psychologist to be physically present at the conference, because she specifically came because of those survivors that were there. Now, this is because this is someone they are very familiar with. They are used to talking to her all the time during their sessions. And her presence was clearly of good effect to them, because they were, once she just walked in through the door, they were very relaxed and they would ask her any questions that they had, and they were very comfortable. They felt very comfortable presenting at the conference. Now, one key observation that came out of this conference is because it is not easy to share your story in front of a crowd, especially when it is something you feel is sensitive. So one of the survivors had a slight mental breakdown, and it was good that the psychologist was there, because after sharing her story, they managed to go out and do some breathing exercises and to do some calming exercises so that she could center herself. And after a few minutes, she was able to come back and join us for the rest of the conference. Now, because this process had steps, our last step was for the survivor leaders to go back to a short meeting with the rest of the team, so that there are six in total, to just lead a discussion on what happened at the conference, what did they hear from other stakeholders, what was presented there, how do they perceive it. And they had a mini discussion on those specific outcomes. This discussion was led by the two survivor leaders within the team, and they received feedback from each other as regards the human trafficking situation in Kenya, based on the perspective that they now got from everyone else in the conference.
Thank you very much to Rehema and to all of you for the great participation.